You're listening to
Promoting Secular Feminism.
Only on Reason Alliance Media.
Coming to you from Reason Alliance Media, this is episode 13, Those Things Will Take a Pounding. I'm Miss B. Haven.
And I'm Demanda Wright.
And we're
Promoting Secular Feminism.
On today's episode, we have for our educated guest, George Elerick. In Feminism 101, we'll talk about social justice humor, and we have a serious toy problem.
This episode is brought to you by Caffeine and Delirium.
Welcome to Educated Guests. Today's guest is George Elerick and also Demanda's Caffeine.
And Delirium.
George, could you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Yes, I love these questions. And by love, I actually mean hate.
They're so broad, aren't they?
They really are, because I almost feel like you're sitting in a room where you should be paying someone by the hour.
I'll take
who
that.
Who are you? Yeah, exactly. Do you accept food stamps? I'm kidding. So who am I? So as you might know, I'm a writer and have been blogging for Huffington Post for a little bit over 5 years. I'm also an actor, so I do that whole acting thing, and I do stand-up comedy and, you know, sing in the shower, and I also write books, and I'm also an activist who has my own film company. So, you know, I've lived in foreign countries like India and have done work over there, and lived in Pakistan and hanging out with their people over there, which are just amazing people. But yeah, so, I mean, there's so much I can share, but I mean, that hopefully kind of gives you at least some, you know, kind of catapult from which to jump from.
Absolutely. Yeah. Great.
It does. So like if you had to pick some labels, like how would you label yourself?
Ooh, and that's why I don't like that question. Because as you probably are very aware, you know, postmodernists, they really, really decry the whole labeling and boxing in and all this kind of stuff. But I think if I were to, let's just kind of.
Well, you can be post. You can be post everything, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Just add a post onto the front.
Oh, that's true. Maybe that is my actual name, my label that I would go for is just post everything. But no, I think for me, it would be, I think the initial three that I shared, you know, it would be actor, comedian, and activist. I think those three. And to me, I don't see a separation between them. I see that, for example, I think acting is meant to have an ethical dimension. I don't like the kind of A-listers who distance themselves from that. I think that to me, if you have a platform like that, that you're supposed to use it in some way in which to respond positively, or at least bring some sort of positive dimension back into society, you know, and same with, you know, comedy and of course activism itself. But yeah, so.
Yeah, that's one of the things that I'm going to try to talk about during this episode of the podcast, is the way in which the activism isn't separated from performers' activities, and specifically with feminist comedians. And I've been thinking about this problem for a while, because often in specifically the secular community, when you're talking about issues of social justice, there's always the idea of like how that, if something goes too far, how that might encroach on free speech. And so I'm particularly interested in your thoughts on comedians and the way in which comedians engage with issues of free speech. And since you said that your work always incorporates activism, how you make that all work together.
Okay, so basically you want me to kind of expound upon how I apply activism within comedy?
Yes.
Or just...
That would be a much more succinct way of saying it, yes.
Thumbs up.
Well, thank you, I try. No, I think, like I said, comedy for me definitively has this kind of integral dimension of activism in it. But I think first and foremost, obviously, I think the initial aspect of that dimension is linguistic, meaning, you know, I think that you use language in such a way in which to challenge preconceived notions about either the way society has operated or is operating or wants to operate, you know. And so for me, like any great activism always starts with theory. You know, and
I told you, Miss B, we had that debate last podcast, theory versus praxis and why we need theory.
Yes.
Sorry to interrupt.
Well, it's really interesting because I think one of your other questions that you sent me was about a friend of mine named Slavoj Žižek. Right. And one of the things that I interviewed him about was this kind of dualistic role between theory and, you know, activism. And of course, as you know, he's very polemic, and he kind of basically ultimately comes out and says, well, fuck the children in Africa. I just want to sit in my house and do theory. Now, if you don't know Slavoj Žižek, and for those who are listening, he is very, very dry humor. He is very, very out there.
And intentionally provocative.
Yes. There. Yes. Yes.
And, for theoretical reasons, I think.
Well, yeah, exactly. Exactly. That's exactly it. You know what I mean? And now, having said all that, if you were to sit down and say, listen, what do you want to do for the rest of your life? Would you want to go to Africa or sit in your room and do theory? He would literally just say, yeah, I want to sit in my room and do theory. So he wasn't kidding about that. What he was trying to challenge was this preconceived notion of the duality and the relationship between the duality between activism and theory. And he says, rather than always trying to say one has to enforce the other, fuck it, let's just choose one and do that well. And so I think the underlying spirit of his critique is like, you know, stop trying to create this kind of pseudo dynamic between this relationship, between these two, and in some sort of Baudrillardian sense, you know, go to the ultimate extreme and do that to the ultimate extreme.
Well, wouldn't he say that there wouldn't be a duality because the practical application would always be based in language, right? In the theoretical aspect.
Yeah.
So, you know, like instead of just like saying it in terms of we're doing theory and we're doing that one thing very well, the things aren't separate at all, right?
Yes, exactly. There's this, in some Zen kind of way of thinking, there's this kind of just integrative dynamic that drives everything. So, you know, to almost kind of, this circles back well, actually, to what you're asking me. You know, in fact, I want to use one of your first questions that you sent me was, you know, what do you think of feminism? Well, it's really interesting because when you look it up, a lot of the definitions that I've kind of found, you know, the American Heritage Dictionary, for example, you know, looked at it from a noun perspective. And I think that's just shit, if I'm honest, because to me, it's verb. It's an action. It's something that you always are doing. It isn't something, well, you know, one day I'm going to be a feminist, right? No. It's something that you're either integrating or you're not integrating, right? And so I think, for me, that's the same with comedy. Like for me, because it has a natural a natural spirit of activism in it, for me, comedy isn't a noun. It's not something that you do in the terms of I do it and I'm done, but it's part of who I am, if that makes sense.
Emphasizing right. The inclusivity of it all too is, I think, helpful rather than making it more exclusive. And that's a lot of times why I, instead of giving people like the definition of feminism, I will talk about the goals and kind of the history of the waves of feminism and where we stand now with like the third wave feminism and beyond. Mm. But I also last week had made a comparison between like the applied and practical sciences.
Yes, that was a very good comparison.
Applied and research in sciences, because there's a lot of arguments similar where you can't have, you know, practical applications of the research without having the applied side. But if you don't have people working on the research side of things, you're never going to make any further progress. And it ends up kind of feeding one to the other back and forth a lot of the times. But many times one side of or the other tends to look down on the other side for doing work in that area. But I've found, at least in my psychology area of work, that most applied people are doing research and a lot of research people are doing applied things, so that there's almost no differentiation between them in an individual.
Yeah,
this is where you always end up, Miss B.
Yeah.
Like, we all should just get along. It's very true.
I'm,
like,
I'm it's a always, very huggy person.
No, it's very wise, but this is where we end up. Okay.
Well, and I mean, I think there's something to be said of that. I mean, I don't think there's anything wrong with kind of utopia. I mean, I'm personally not for utopia in the sense that I don't think we'll ever get there. I think it's a dream of religion, and I think it's an idea in which that drives us. And I don't think that's necessarily wrong or evil, but just like Zizek says, he says, when you get more than one fantasy, meaning worldview, paradigm, you know, ethic, whatever word you kind of want to fill in the blank there, when you get more than one in a room, someone's going to have to eventually give theirs up, you know, and that's true. I mean, you sit in a room with more than one person, you know, you're eventually going to have a different opinion, you know?
Right. Well, we would have to give up the, like, eventually, if we could potentially reach utopia, it would be one version of utopia, right? But we could all sit in a room and struggle over our existences and work toward whatever utopia we wanted to work toward, you know, all in the same room. Like, we don't have to have the same goals initially. I think you're right, though, that eventually, the closer you get to any type of achievement, then one person's version of what needs to happen always ends up winning out over the other.
And utopia would be boring.
As fuck.
Yeah.
Do you know?
We'd all be just doing pottery together. Hey, how are you?
This is why I don't
I'm
like
so
nice.
I'm so bad at pottery.
This is why I don't like nice people. Like, if you're around really nice people all the time, it's really boring.
Oh my God, you must hate me. I am the person.
No, I'm really afraid of you. You're going to whip me when
I'm an atheist. Can I have a hug?
I like my people with a dash of sarcasm.
So you like Mr. Haven over there?
I do. Yeah,
you guys really get along. It's nice. So one of the questions that we had for you was, as someone who works in the media, could you give us your thoughts on the role media plays in shaping our ideas of femininity?
Oh my gosh.
It's a big question.
That's like a 6-part series. That is, I mean, for me, that's exactly what I'm fighting. I mean, is because I think the media is, well, let's just use the word that it's actually originated from. You know, it mediates for us. It mediates our worldview, it mediates our ethics, it mediates our nationalism, you know, and that isn't to say that you can't distance yourself from it, but I think we would be irresponsible if we tried to undermine how much of a grasp of our paradigms that it actually affects on a daily basis. Mm-hmm. And so for me, media doesn't just mean clicking on the TV. I'm talking about billboards, magazines. So anything and everything that could fit within the kind of visual or audio, you know, format of media, you know, and also language. I mean, language for me is media. You know, it's just another way of communicating. And I love Baudrillard's critique on it because he says, you know, a lot of times we'll sit and we'll watch news and we'll just sit and watch news and think that we're, you know, communicating in one way or another. But he goes, the major issue is that it's always one-sided, always, you know, in the sense that you are always being indoctrinated, you know. And Jacques Lacan, a psychoanalyst that Zizek loves to use, he uses this word schizophrenia in and throughout his psychoanalytic work. And the idea is almost to the point of someone who actually goes through a schizophrenic experience because they become inundated with so many images that they take on the truth of those images. No matter how many images are coming their way, those images become the truth of who they are, their identity, their ethics, who they were, who they are, who they're to become. All of these kinds of dynamics are always constantly at play, even if it's just in a subconscious level.
Oh,
right?
My God. So we're not. So we are what we tweet.
Yes. Yes.
Fuck.
Exactly. You know,
I'm hilarious.
You're like, I love myself.
I love me.
I know. I keep on doing this. but yeah, I mean, the media to me is one of those things where it kind of holds the good and the bad in and of itself, you know? And I mean, I'm a retro anarchist. And so sometimes I think it'd be better. We just throw TVs away and just, you know, we'll just all sit in our little cubbies, like, you know, our stereotypical old men and women who kind of just sit in their rocking chairs, you know, sipping their drinks and just being done with life. But obviously that's not where I'm at. Otherwise I wouldn't be working with Huffington Post.
Or maybe listening to radio dramas while knitting in your office. Not like I was doing the other day.
Yeah. Like the Christmas story, you know, you shoot your eye out, kid.
Oh gosh.
Yeah.
I'm practicing at being a grandma early.
Well, I mean, since you guys actually are also involved in some form of media, what are your thoughts on it as well? You know, where do you stand on the issue of media and its role?
I definitely think it's improving. And we've talked a bit about this on the podcast about especially this past year being a great year for depictions of women in film. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, we've talked a lot about the history of depictions of women in film and the way in which that's now changing, but hasn't quite changed enough.
And I think a lot of the conversation about transgender people and non-binary gender people being included in
watch Sense8
media. I mean, not just Sense8. Glee has had a non-binary person on that show for quite a while now, and it really makes a difference being able to have that conversation in, you know, kids who are in middle school watching that kind of thing and having those conversations early on so that it becomes a normal part of their culture very early on in their, you know, growing up. It's really cool how that's becoming such a normal thing. And I don't really like how Caitlyn Jenner is becoming the spokesperson for transgender people. And most trans people that I've talked to about that issue have also said, you know, she doesn't really need to be the spokesperson for transgender people, but there's a lot of responsibility on her head of being so much in the spotlight that people are, you know, talking about her. Whether or not it's positive or negative is not up to her, but that the conversation is happening at all is a really big change in our culture.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's somewhat simplistic to argue that all that we need are characters to identify with, right? That I can only identify in one way, and therefore I need a woman to wield a lightsaber, right?
Well, yeah, and it's not like we don't identify with male characters, right, for that matter.
Well, and I think you actually bring up a really, really good point is this kind of desire for like a messianic figure.
Right.
You know, and this desire for this other person to kind of stand and fight for us, you know, and to me, that's completely irresponsible in the sense that, you know what, if we're going to talk about feminism and feminism and its progress, and well, then we also need to talk about our role in it, you know, not just, well, who's this person and how are they and what are they doing for feminism, right? And I mean, that tends to be a sociological dimension, especially in the West, where we are so drawn in by personality, you know, the cult of personality. And I mean, someone who's in the acting industry, this is literally what you get almost every day or every time you're exposed to doing acting. You are literally just like, it's so tempting to actually be drawn, oh my gosh, there's Samuel L. Jackson or blah, 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 blah. Like whoever it might be, you literally almost just through words reify their character, their persona. And then without even knowing it or without even intending to, you turn that person into this kind of figure or this kind of Grecian statue, you know, like, look at this. They're beautiful. Oh my gosh, they're an A-lister, right? And so we create these kind of inner perversions of, you know, like, this is who I want to be. This is, you know, they embody everything that I want to be.
Well, this is exactly what's happened with the state of U.S. politics at the moment, which you must be having a field day watching from the UK.
It's even happened in like the secular podcasting community. I mean, in following some of like Beth Presswood or Tracy Harris's Facebook posts about like fans talking about the Atheist Experience or even talking about the Godless Bitches podcast. Like there is such a huge following with that, that they get some really creepy like stalker emails and Facebook things and all this kind of stuff. And it's like, they just feel like they're just people who had a podcast and answer questions on, you know, on the internet. It's no big deal because they're just people just like everybody else. And, it weirds them out having this sort of celebrity thing follow them around.
Samuel L. Jackson played golf with Donald Trump.
Well, I guess he's got his vote.
And that wasn't a segue. Why are you looking so confused?
Because Donald Trump isn't that good at golf, is he?
Well, no, he just.
How could you focus with that hair? I'm serious. I would just be like staring the whole time, going, "Is it going to stay on? What if there's a breeze? Like, I would be legitimately concerned about what's going to happen."
Do you know the person that I'm most concerned for at the moment? I wouldn't want to be would be Ivanka. Can you imagine being Ivanka and then Donald being on the campaign trail?
She's constantly being compared to Michelle Obama, and I really don't appreciate that.
Why would they be comparing his daughter to?
I don't
the first
know.
Lady?
I don't know. They've been comparing his daughter to the first lady. They've been comparing his wife to the first lady. I mean, it's like all of these women who are involved with possible presidential candidates or nominees, rather. They're only. Value, it seems, is to be a support mechanism for them or to add to their bad reputation by doing things like spending money on dresses for themselves or spending money on plastic surgery or whatever. It's like, I don't give a shit if you have expensive dresses or an expensive haircut or expensive plastic surgery. If you're spending your own goddamn money, then do what you want to. Not my business. If it's tax dollars, I will get in your face about it.
I think that's it. You know, the whole how we become so entrenched in the kind of minutiae of everyday like lifestyle of one person, you know, to the point of almost nausea, you know, again, to me, that just doesn't ring true with reality. Because I don't really like, just like you, I don't really give a shit. What, I mean, if their toilet is diamond studded or if they, you know, wipe their asses with toilet paper or, you know, shells on a beach. Like I don't care. Like, I mean, as long as what they're doing is in some way, you know, fighting for the oppressed or making the world better through humor or whatever their gift is, as long as they're using it in such a way to progress. You know, I mean, obviously with some hedonistic enjoyment, you know, with a side of that. But I mean, also, you know, just with the reality that, you know, I could really care less what you do, you know, between, you know, what you're not doing.
Yeah. Between the sheets is your business.
No, I think I really want to know that.
Well, you know. That's a great t-shirt, though. You know what I mean? A great t-shirt.
What are you doing between the sheets?
That's going to be like someday we'll get really famous and we'll interview all these presidential nominees and we'll be like, so tell us about your sex life. You know, how are things going? How often do you have sex? You know,
what's your favorite brand of lubrication?
Is sodomy illegal in your state?
Yeah. Do you really want to know about Bernie Sanders and what's his what are happening to his sheets or whether they're sticky?
Nope. I'm not saying. Don't want to know. Don't care.
Yeah.
I honestly just if you
I
do your
I
job, just
know.
Do your job. It's fine.
Like just
yes.
I would,
hedonistic part of me.
I would want to know if something was going on inappropriately in the workplace, but you know that's also something that is a completely different conversation.
I did not have sexual relations with that.
Oh no! This is the thing that's bugging me the most about politics right now. Regardless of course, I'm a liberal. I think anyone who listens to the podcast would know that. Like that's sort of like how I where I
what?
Lean. like, you know, I'm not being confessional or anything here.
We are getting a divorce.
Or progressive or whatever label, you know, best suits our politics. But anyway, so the thing that bugs me the most at the moment is this whole rehashing of Clinton's sexcapades. Right?
Yeah, no shit. In why a way does which, that matter?
This is why it matters to me. Okay? Because it's all rehashed in terms of Hillary Clinton, right?
Yeah.
Bill Clinton's approval rating right now publicly is wonderful. Everyone loves Bill Clinton.
Because he's not in office.
At the same time that they can talk about who he diddled and why,
yeah,
right? And the only person that reflects poorly on is his spouse.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, yeah, I just...
It's a complete undermining of her role as a woman.
She wasn't involved in sexual relationships in the workplace.
Like, what, was she
with
under
somebody?
The desk watching Monica blow him? No.
Well, we don't know that.
We don't have that footage yet.
Well, if so, she wasn't really cheating. It was all consensual, right?
There you go. Then that it's fine, except that it's happening at the workplace.
That's not fair if you can't get a blowjob at the workplace.
That's true.
You should have just, you know, at least put NSFW on the door and then she wouldn't have came in.
No, what? I think it's a tie on the door, isn't it?
Yeah.
No.
I don't know. A flag?
I don't know.
What, what nation's flag do you fly on the door? We're going down now.
Oh. For like 10 years, it's been Afghanistan.
Like, yeah, we're not. Don't pick a nation. Like, do you know how many people are going to piss off if you actually pick a nation?
I know. Pissed off enough of them to last. And then I thought, that's not going to go so good.
No, don't actually pick one. It's funny to think about picking one.
Yeah. Well, because I mean, you know, James Franco, you know, the whole North Korea, like movie and all that kind of stuff.
But oh, geez.
I thought, well, you know.
Oh, we might get hacked. That'd be kind of fun.
Oh, sweet. We got to piss off China first.
There's a lot of people there. I don't think we should do that.
That takes too much effort.
Yeah, seriously. They don't even need bombs. They just get to go like a whole bunch of people together and say boom. Like it is just completely overpopulated.
Oh my gosh. Okay, so in talking about our politics a little bit, here's a question for you. How do you feel about the state of feminist movement
God,
in the West?
Oh my God, who wrote these fucking questions?
I don't know.
They're so broad.
Fuck you.
I know.
Yeah, I mean, this is I'm just thinking this is quite a broad question because obviously, and in one sense, I was probably unfair to ask it in such a way because I kind of left so much room for you guys. I think.
Do you know I'm retaliating though? That's why I asked you all the same question.
Yeah. Well, I figured it was some sort of like karma just working itself out.
That's the Freudian thing that's happening during this podcast.
Oh, yes, oh. Yeah. We audio make purgatory.
We make karma happen on this show.
Yeah. We can sell it in a bottle. You know, like Compassion by Mother Teresa, the new perfume. But yeah, so I think in terms of the state of it, I think I'm a bit more pessimistic because I was hearing that you guys were being very optimistic about the role of it in media, which I think is great. Don't get me wrong. I mean, I think there are great strides that are happening, but I think I'm a little bit more impatient with the politicking that's going in between all of the progress. So, you talk about, you know, the whole Hillary Clinton, you know, and focusing on Bill Clinton's, you know, behavior. And to me, that's part of the politicking. So here we have already, we've already had a black president, which is huge. And then now we actually have a woman running for president, which itself is huge, you know, in terms of our history. And I think that's great. And that's a positive stride. But then you have the shit in the middle that you have to deal with that slows down the progress because what you're going to have is then you're going to have the cult of the shit fest of Fox News who ends up turning everything into some sort of conservative dynamic, you know, and some sort of apocalyptic end, you know. And so for me, the state of feminism in the West, I think, could do a lot better. And I'm not saying the women that are fighting for it aren't doing it. I'm talking about the progress on the receiving end of the work of those women. So what I'm saying is that the women keep doing it and they're doing amazing things. And not just women, obviously men as well. And men need to use their desire for equality, you know, as, you know, in any context as well. But I guess what I'm saying is that on the receiving end, I find it a lot slower. And I mean, you know, I do activism, and, you know, one of my, previous interviews for Huffington Post was Carl Deeks, you know, he was talking about how slow again it is. I mean, like how, you know, racism is such a big issue still, and, you know, and, how, there's so much change. And even though, you know, it's still getting a lot of media attention and so on and so on and so on, there's still not the progress that we should be seeing, if that makes sense. And so, that's a really roundabout way of saying it. But I think if I were just to kind of encapsulate where I stand on it, I think I'm a bit more pessimistic in terms of its progress. I'm not saying that there hasn't been progress. I'm not saying that the progress that has been had isn't positive. I'm saying that on the receiving end of men and women who are, you know, working their asses off to actually fight for gender equality and gender inclusion, or even, you know, beyond the gender binary inclusion, you know, are doing amazing work. But the way it's being received for me isn't happening fast enough.
Do you think that that's possibly a place where religion is playing a big role in hesitating to help with that side of things?
Hell yes. And I purposely said hell yes, because it's religion.
I really liked how you italicized our yes for the one word answer on that article. Thank you. That is great.
Yeah, I love that. Exactly. Well, because I know that there was context to that yes. It wasn't just yes.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Right. Oh, so, yeah. That's a yes. Hell yes.
yes. I mean, I think there's a huge underrated and also simultaneously overrated dimension of religion in terms of how it plays out, because of how it's tied in to American politics and the American psyche, you know. And I simultaneously loathe, well, actually not simultaneously, I just loathe the idea that we have tied religion into politics. You know, I mean, I'm having lived over here for about 8 years, I see the positive aspects of it being separated. And I think that would be, I think, my critique in terms of where America stands in terms of its relationship to itself, really. And when I say to itself, what I'm really referring to is how it's seen across the world. And so when I lived in India, you know, it was really, really interesting, because
I travel and I claim I'm Canadian.
Yes. There's probably some sort of benefit to that. I mean, I have to have some access to syrup.
Everyone loves Canadians.
I never even get that, like the benefit of the doubt thing. Everybody just asked me what province I'm from because of my accent. Because I grew up in Michigan. So it's like, oh, hey, you must be Canadian. Like when I went to Canada, they asked me what province I'm from. Like,
I'm like, I'm Canadian, and don't make me say anything with an IGHT. You'll know I'm from the South.
Ooh, sorry about that.
Sorry. No, I know. I lived in Canada for a little bit as well. And I'm telling you, man, I mean, it was so funny, because they're kind of like, they're the loft to a great party. You know what I mean? Like geographically. And I'm kidding. But I mean, it's...
Poor Canada.
Oh,
yeah.
They make
really
exactly. Great science fiction, though.
They do.
Yeah, I like all the Canadian science fiction
and
shows.
Thanks, Vancouver, for being every city ever.
Yeah, it is.
Yes.
It's great.
That's probably why they write great science fiction, because they have marijuana legalized, you know? It helps you really, really think through.
There you go. Solution to a problem.
Yes. I did some work downtown there, and they actually had areas where people were allowed to shoot up. And I mean, it blew my mind, because, you know, I'm originally from Los Angeles, where some of that stuff is in your face anyways. But it was just really, really uncanny, where I just saw this lady shooting up, and she was sitting on the hood of a cop car. You know, it was just like, yeah, everything's fine. I'm just going to get high right here.
Goodness. Well, it looks like we're going to have to wrap things up for the interview here. Thank you so much for coming onto the show.
Thank
you. And we look forward to a future friendship. And also, we would like to honor you with an honorary membership in our penis gallery.
Awesome. I'll take a picture and send it over.
Yeah, there aren't really any benefits, but...
Yeah. We should start putting them on the wall back here. That would be awesome.
Headshots.
There we go.
That, yes. You guys think that was... But that was a... That was a pun.
Huh.
You didn't think that was funny?
But I'm
headshot? Come on.
That's a pun. We need it. We need a sound effect for puns.
And the penis gallery.
So we should probably
if
say,
I have to explain it, it's not going to be funny.
We should probably
well,
say
thank
this
you,
safe
by the way.
Word.
I just wanted to say thank you to each of you and also the work that you guys are up to. I mean, to me, this is a great and necessary platform, you know, and these are conversations I think that need to be happening on a daily basis. And so, you know, what you are all doing together, I think, is just amazing. So just hopefully be encouraged and thank you for hospitality and just for allowing me to come on and have a chat with you.
Thank you. Would you like to join us in the saying of the safe word?
It's banana.
Sure. A euphemism. Great. I like it.
Bananas and pajamas coming down the stairs.
Coming down the stairs.
Yeah, bananas and pajamas. I forgot the rest of it. Sorry, guys. I'm so out of the loop.
And you have children.
I know, because they're so stuck on Nick Jr. There's no like flipping bananas and pajamas, you know?
It's pretty old. I think it's a 90s thing or 2000s.
Yeah, because I watched some of it in like a time when I was still fairly young enough to maybe enjoy things like that.
Yeah, that's the problem.
We still haven't figured out.
I don't want to talk about how old you are.
I always thought it was just a big drug trip because, I mean, think about it. Bananas wearing human clothes. It just never really sat well with me.
And hanging out with teddy bears.
Yes,
what?
Exactly.
We just wanted to take a moment to thank some people who have seen us on iTunes and rated us and left some great reviews. So we just wanted to say thank
you. Our listeners, we have some.
We have some listeners.
I'm so excited.
You haven't turned everyone away from us, Amanda.
Oh,
not everyone.
I'm still trying.
So we wanted to give a shout out to Lou Madrid 122311, Relim _ D, Trav Mamone. I wonder who that is.
I don't know.
And Mega Library Girl on iTunes. Thank you so much for rating and reviewing us. And if you're a fan,
could we hear some of the reviews?
Rate and review us on iTunes. Well, let's see. The latest one from Mega Library Girl said, "Sparkly goodness with a banana chaser. Five stars."
I like that one.
Yeah, I know. I like the bananas. she says, I assume because it says girl, but it might not be a girl. "This has become one of my favorite podcasts. The hosts are funny, fun to listen to, honest, and smart. The skits are really cute, too. I love Princess Sparkle Farts. Yay."
Now, what was her name?
Mega Library Girl.
Mega Library Girl, you have fabulous taste.
Absolutely. And she continues by saying, "I hope someday you make a reel of just the skits, especially PSF Undercover. If you're a feminist and you like to laugh and hear other cool feminists talk, you'll enjoy this podcast." So thank you so much. And we will definitely have to do like a full-on comedy sketch-only episode. That would be so cool. And maybe we'll do like at some point, we'll just put all of the PSF episodes together into one thing so you can like listen to the whole serialized thing. That would be
That's
awesome.
A great idea.
Yeah, I like
Thank
that.
Thank you, Mega Library Girl.
Thank you. So if you're subscribed on iTunes, definitely rate and review us on there. And on Spreaker, you can also leave comments and we'll see those comments if you leave them on like Spreaker or on our website too. So thank you for communicating via that. And I don't know if there's a rating system on Stitcher.
We're at 5 listeners now.
Yeah, 5 whole listeners. Yep. And our waitress today was saying how she liked to listen to our podcast.
See?
I was so happy. Thanks, Brittany. So thanks again. And we hope you continue to enjoy PSF on iTunes.
Hey,
Spreaker,
we have more listeners than Dogma Debate.
Stitcher and
they only have 4.
Oh, okay. They've got 4.
Yeah,
we got
there's
5.
A whole thing about the 4th listener.
Yeah.
Yeah, we have 5.
We got 5 now, guys.
Because it was Brittany. Brittany's our 5th listener.
Yeah.
So that means that we have more listeners than Dogma Debate.
Yeah, she's totally going to hear this too, and she's going to be like,
it's time for Feminism 101 when Princess Sparkle Farts has a bunch of questions and really no answers to the mysterious and murky world of feminism and social justice. Warning, what follows is the most unfunny segment about being funny you could imagine. Negin Farsad begins a YouTube video with these words: I think social justice lands better when it's encased in a dick joke. I think so too. She has a video called How Dirty Jokes Can Promote Equality in Muslim Culture. She's an Iranian-American Muslim feminist, self-described. Her comedy is both personal and satirical, and we're going to give you a bit of a clip on STDs.
In my areas, I recently had to get an STD test because I was a raging slut for a period of my life that ended last week. And the good news is that my vagina is closed and disease-free, and, you know, until marriage or until someone takes me out to dinner at a restaurant with a Zagat rating of at least 8 out of 30, I'm easy. Okay. But what's really scary about getting yourself tested and STD tests in general, they're just so scary, right? And so I actually decide to tell my mom about it, right? And it's already hard enough to say to your mom, look, lady, I fucked a bunch of dudes and I might be diseased. But to say that in Farsi, in a language where I don't know what the word is for sex, nor do I know that there is a word for sex, is all the more radically awkward. Because my mom was like, Negin, why are you scared? Have you had intergender flesh relation?
Her comedy redresses the problem that she describes as Iranians and Muslims more broadly being closed off about sex and sexual issues. And another example of a feminist comedian, Nadia Kamil, she has a clip called Drunk Driver Safety Advice that she uses to talk about victim blaming and sexual assault. She also has a clip about burlesque shows, which we'll give you a bit of here.
Do something incredibly entertaining for you people. I'm going to do some burlesque. I have a tricky relationship with burlesque. I am a feminist. Thank you. It's the new sexy, guys. Consensual sexy. And I'm part of a club in London called the Alternative Comedy Memorial Society. We're a really silly comedy club where the whole idea is to do weird things and different things that won't work in other clubs. And a couple of years ago, a comedian who shall remain Tom Tuck booked a burlesque act for the club. And what the burlesque act was a woman dressed as Margaret Thatcher. And already I was uncomfortable. A woman dressed as Margaret Thatcher who stripped down to a hairy Union flag merkin. And the only thing I really learned from it was that I don't care how patriotic your pubes are.
Both of these examples of feminist comedians come from a 2015 article called 10 Feminist Comedians You Should Be Paying Attention To. So I'm the last person to write about feminist comedians. I don't know anything about feminist comedians, hence the reason why I had to get an article to tell me who they were. So people who meet me in person have often wondered if I have a sense of humor. And I don't really know anything about masculine or feminine or comedians anywhere in between. So it took me years to learn to appreciate humor as a genre. It took me years to appreciate Mr. Wright's never-ending ability to make anything into a fart joke. I laugh at them now, but it took me a while to get there. So basically, funny ain't my thing. That's what I'm trying to say. And I'm more the serious type. So how in the hell am I going to turn this into a rant about the secular community? So here's that. So often, when feminism is brought up or any other social justice issue, there's a common rejoinder to a broad range of those questions or issues. And that's they're too politically correct, by which I think they mean there's someone's trying to limit their free speech. So the most effective version of this argument for me is, hey, I'm a comedian. You can't say I can't say something. That's my job. Nothing can be off limits for a comedian. And I'm prone to agree with that. So most often the argument goes something like this. How can, insert your favorite comedian here, be funny if he can't say insert your favorite controversial word or topic here. See, I told you I don't really know anything about comedy. I don't even have appropriate examples. So I thought I'd try to find out if there is such a thing as social justice comedy, hence Nadia and
Negin. Yeah.
Look, I'm learning.
There we go.
Oh my God, Nadia and Negin. Okay, I got this.
Like, back on the reels.
I had to scroll up because I didn't know who they were. Okay, Nadia and Negin. So I thought I'd try to find out something about social justice comedy and whether or not there's such a thing as comedy that isn't the sort of as long as I'm insulting everyone type thing, then I'm being fair. So instead of listening to a bunch of comedy, except for Nadia and Negin, what I did do was read an article. I went the academic route. Imagine that.
Of course.
Yeah, I did that. And it's an article by Dr. Nancy Goldman. It's called Comedy and Democracy, The Role of Humor in Social Justice. And she says humor is a social corrective. I think I knew that part. And I think this is, though, the point that most secular comedians are trying to make. They're saying that, hey, feminist or hey, social justice advocates, what you're doing has gone too far. It's encroaching on our free speech. And in some cases, they'd be right. There have been platforming instances where some people haven't been allowed to speak on college campuses because their views are controversial. And there was one campus that I think proclaimed the entire campus a safe space. So they've been not allowing people to speak there. So yes, in those instances, what is a necessary social justice move, safe spaces, went too far. So where the problem comes in is when you take that last sentence, social justice spaces being necessary but having gone too far, and change it to what started out as something good has now become something bad, something that we need to make fun of. So this last statement means that there's no longer something good about it, that it needs to be done away with. So why not just say safe spaces are a good thing? I'm going to make comedy that promotes it. And I think instances where it goes too far are ridiculous. And I'm going to make comedy about that too, instead of saying there's nothing valuable in safe spaces anymore. So I think that would be possible. And I think Negin and Nadia are examples of how that would be possible. So what I, after having listened to them and thinking about this debate in the secular community, I have some questions, and I don't know if I have answers to them, but I think the answers to these questions are what would lead us to something that I would call social justice comedy. So can comedians who want to bring to consciousness uncritical thought patterns, which is what I think activist comedians do, can what they say about safe spaces being taken too far, can they say that in a way that still promotes the idea of that space as productive? Can we also subvert authority and expose hypocrisy, which is, again, what I think social justice comedians would be doing, while promoting positive goals of inclusion and reconciliation? So is there a way that comedy itself can become a safe space where laughter can be used to take down our defenses to make us more receptive to justice? So Dr. Goldman says comedy can make us recognize ourselves. It can favor the underdog. It can critique those in power, which I think I would agree with all of those statements. And I particularly, though, would like to think about ways in which, like, the theory of comedy would allow us to make fun of something like a safe space without critiquing the entire idea as negative. Right. So that's what I'm getting at. But I want to mention one example of where all of these worlds seem to collide at once. And that's with Goldsmiths in the UK and Kate Smurthwaite, who is a secular feminist comedian. So she was going to perform there. And instead of getting to perform, her event was canceled. So there's a couple different stories about what happened. But basically, some people are saying that the Goldsmiths feminist group, who have been known to not allow other people to speak on campus, or their social union group, which is the group that declared the whole campus a safe space. So people are saying that Smurthwaite's event was canceled because the feminist group disagrees with her on her view about prostitution. Basically, she's not feminist enough. And other people are saying that the event was canceled because there wasn't going to be a lot of attendance. So Smurthwaite herself has written about social media trolling and has been accused of not being able to take a joke. Of course, she has been, of being triggered and of needing a safe safe space. So she's been on the other side of these issues. And what I'm interested in is if you're someone like Smurthwaite, you're a secular feminist comedian, and this happens to you, I'm interested in seeing what her comedy is going to look like after this. So like how she deals with all of these things. And it's pretty recent, so that hasn't happened yet. But that's sort of where I think I'm going to find the answers to these questions. So she's been if she's been originally pro safe space in this sense, sort of the LGBTQ students having a group with a space on campus where they can be surrounded by people who aren't going to question their identities, sort of safe space, pro safe space in that sort of definition of the term, how can she use her comedy to critique the Goldsmith situation that she was just in without attacking the original concept of safe spaces altogether? So that's my question that I'm left with. I don't really have any answers, but I think what I would like from you guys is, having written a lot of heavily satirical pieces yourself.
What?
Yes. Ooh,
is that what I did?
Mr. Haven. And you, Miss B, are the one who has introduced me to a lot of comedy. So if you guys have examples that you can think of where we're getting at some of these issues, sort of being pro-social justice, being an advocate of free speech, but not having that come into conflict, as in, I'm not allowed to say this word or this concept.
I think a lot more of that controversy comes up with regard to jokes about transgender people. Because
the whole Ricky Gervais and Golden Globes, yeah, and Caitlyn Jenner.
Well, it's not just that. I mean, there are a lot of sensitive topics that lots of people feel that you can never make light of, ever. Examples are like child molestation, rape, things like that. People are saying it's
race,
never
gender. I mean, right, that, right. There have always been topics that,
right,
are going to be
people
targets.
Are always going to say that, like, those topics are completely, you know, they're not available to make fun of, ever, you know. And then there are going to be people, and Ricky Gervais is definitely one of these individuals who says that you can't do that. You cannot, you know, just simply say you that something, an idea, a concept is off the table. And so I think that probably the truth is somewhere in between. You know, you can be somebody who's able to take something that is a tasteless subject and find some humor in it.
Do you think it's like a matter of, maybe, I don't know. So I'm trying to think about how it would actually work.
Right.
Right. So maybe some type of, and if I'm getting any of this wrong, please tell me, but like ironic misdirection or something, where you begin the joke about someone who's transgender and the punchline has nothing to do with being transgender.
Yeah, a lot of times. But let's just take an example that I can remember right now of Patton Oswalt, who does a joke about abortion, and which is something that obviously, you know, isn't intrinsic. There's nothing intrinsically funny about abortion. You didn't get an abortion or anything like that. But it was more about the day after pill. And it was just basically, when he was younger, he had had a wild night of sex with this young woman that he barely knew. And then afterwards she was like,
without protection, was
without
the
protection,
key part of,
yes,
that, yeah.
wild sex, unprotected sex, the kind that you have when you're young and stupid. And after that, the young lady turned to him and said, we have to get a morning after pill right now, because quote, you came in my brain, you know, you came so hard.
That got God's attention.
Yes. So they were like, oh yeah, that's the sensible thing to do. That's the grown up thing to do. So they go to a Planned Parenthood, and they're like, we can't actually give you that, because you have to have a prescription, but you can go across the street to the Costco and you can just buy it. And they were like, fuck, that's crazy. That's, you know, you know, and then he says that they're going across the parking lot. They're talking with one another and they're saying, you know, we're doing the responsible thing. You know, we're doing the grown up thing. We have to do this, but I could actually see myself having a baby with you. We're not, we're not going to do that. It's not an option. But, you know, it's you know, I could, and they both had that little conversation, you know, of imagining themselves having children. And then when they got in the Costco, there were all these, you know, screaming children running around and, you know, that kind of like thing. And he said that, you know, and he's joking and he says, you know, you will pay a skinhead to kick your pregnant wife in the stomach, you know, after going into a Costco
or Walmart
or you know, whatever. And that's, it's all about the framework, you know, and the context of how he's putting it together. And a lot of times the things that elicit humor are things that are shocking, that are surprising, that are the juxtaposition of unlike things. And so, you have these, you know, sort of extreme ideas put into a context where you didn't expect it to be. And he's telling this little, real tender story at a moment. And then he's talking about like these ideas that you pop up in your head that are, they're sort of extremes. Like I would do something, you know, totally insane like that rather than have to be a responsible, you know, parent. Even though that might be ugly, it's still a truth, I think, that a lot of people can possibly, you know, empathize with. And that's the only example that comes immediately to mind.
I think a part of it that makes it, at least in my mind, more acceptable is that it's not like implying that she's at fault somehow for having had sex with him.
Right, right.
For having had unprotected sex knowingly. And that it's just they're both responsible for this, so they have to both go get a morning after.
But we're talking about somebody. Patton Oswalt is a fairly liberal, you know, progressive comedian. Let's find somebody who's not. Let's go find somebody who's notorious for his portrayed misogyny on stage, and that's Andrew Dice Clay, right? Very, very famous comedian. I don't know if you're familiar with him. But his entire routine is misogynistic, he portrays this character on stage of just being a lout, of being, you know, and you're not exactly sure how much of it is a performance. It's kind of like a Stephen Colbert kind of thing, or is this actually just his personality? You know, and he says a lot of really just ugly, you know, terrible things about women, about relationships. You know, that sort of thing. And so you have to ask yourself, the real question is not defending comedians that you like Patton Oswalt is a comedian I haven't liked. It's the people that you don't like Andrew Dice Clay or whoever, you know, Larry the Cable Guy or whoever the fuck, you know, you know, the these kinds of guys. This is like, you know, and those are the things. It's just like when they're saying something that you don't like, when you think is tasteless and everything like that, do you think that they have the right to say that? Do you think that they should have a safe place to say things like that because they're comedians?
Yeah, I think they should be able to say whatever they want to say. Like, I'm pro free speech, but then again, they're not going to be out there saying it, I'm a feminist, right? I'm doing something for feminism,
right? Exactly. And some may argue that in some kind of weird, perverse way.
Well, I mean, they say, you know, there could be something to be said for the whole Poe comedy thing, where you take it to such an extreme that people go, wait a minute.
Right. And to explain to everybody what a Poe is, a Poe's law is a reference to this internet meme law, which says that it's almost impossible to tell the difference between a satire of fundamentalist ideas and fundamentalist ideas, that they're almost impossible to distinguish. That's what Poe's law stands
for. Yeah. Tina Fey doing Sarah Palin.
Correct.
She uses all her own words.
Exactly. When you that's kind of like just listening to that, it's like because I've heard that in reference to Donald Trump, people have said, you know, there are conspiracy theories out there that said he's not really doing, he's not really for real. He's doing this as a, as just to show the, how stupid Republicans are, or that it's a part of a conspiracy theory in order to take down the Republican Party, in order, because he's really friends with
based
the Clintons.
Based on a lot of the reactions of Republicans in the party who were at that retreat that was going on this past week, they kind of sounded like they thought that was probably a thing too.
Right. So yeah, but I do get what you're saying is that like there's that's always like the like eternal battle in comedy is.
Yeah, I think you have a choice, right? You can be someone, to use your example, because I have none of my own, like Andrew Dice Clay, mm-hmm. and he's going to be out there. He's going to be doing comedy. That's great. Nobody's limiting his free speech.
Right. Exactly.
But if you choose to, you can also be a comedian that and be funny and be a feminist and advocate for social justice, right? That
exactly,
those things aren't in conflict, I think, the way that they're often portrayed in sort of secular social media discussions.
Right, precisely.
Things.
And not only that, it's often associated with a certain type of female comedian, like Janine Garofalo is one that's often put up there as being, oh, she's talking about periods and she's talking about this shit. And that's, you know, it's unclean and it's gross. And like,
it's unclean.
Yeah, it's like, you know,
Simpsons.
These old white people, you know, talking about like, oh, that's not comedy, you know? And so there's like a stereotype of created. It's like, well, if you're going to be one of these social justice warrior female, quote unquote comedians, then that's what you're going to be like. So, the idea is that, like a guy couldn't be, you know, speaking about, you know, feminist ideas or anything of that nature, which is, of course,
it also kind of seems like, you somehow couldn't make it in comedy without being exploitative of people other than yourself, wherein most people find self-deprecating comedy to be really funny, and actually it works just fine. But you can also, you know, be kind of lifting people up and making fun of them without being exploitative,
which is, I think, what I mostly learned from Negin Farsad's clips when I was watching some of her stand-up, was that her stories are always very personal.
Right.
Exactly. It comes from a very personal place, and it's self-deprecating, and it's from a perspective sort of inside the culture that she's critiquing,
mm-hmm.
which is what I think makes it both funny, right? Very personal, very relatable, and also satirical of that culture.
And, you know, a male comedian that I would suggest is at least a possible candidate for somebody who does speak very open and very, very honestly about like relationships, and I would call a feminist, is Louis C.K. And because he's got a very like a great routine about how like older guys are all about like much younger women. And about like he doesn't find, you know, anything terribly attractive about that, because he wants, you know, an older, experienced woman, and gives personal examples.
The sadder, wiser gal.
Yes. Yeah. The sadder, wiser gal for Louis C.K. But in his he's very similar in that when he discovered his voice, it was extremely personal. He was talking about things that were very, very personal to him, and a lot of really, you know, a lot of dark subjects, because he does talk about stuff like that. He talks about rape. He talks about child molestation. He talks about like all these dark things, but he does it in a very just a very, very honest way. And he's not above self-critique at all, especially his show. Which he writes almost exclusively himself, Louis C.K., where he is the main character, and he does illustrate, like, for instance, which is a better example of what I just gave, is that one of the skits that he does on that show is where he goes sort of on a blind date with this really funny young lady, but she's a little heavy set, right? And so throughout the date, he's kind of putting off vibes like, yeah, I mean, we're having a lot of fun, and we really like each other, but, you know, I don't know if this is going to really work out. And she points out to him, it's just like, you know, if somebody were to see us on the street together, they would think that we were a really good match, right? That that we're matched really well, because he's not in extraordinarily good shape himself.
Like, we're both 5.5.
Yeah, exactly. Right. You know, and we're a good match, but for some reason there's this you know, prevalence in our culture that like guys have to be with, you know, much more quote unquote attractive women.
Yes, they can be a 3, and depending on how much money they have, they can date like a perfect 10.
Right, right. And it's up to women to sort of have to deal with guys, you know, below their level or whatever. But for guys, you can't do that. You know, you've got to aim higher. And I mean, he was totally the bad guy in that. He was totally the jackass in that skit. He's writing about very personal experiences. And I think that's the kind of thing that you can do.
I think too, I've seen some examples out there, of comedy that's being called feminist. And I'm not sure it is.
Yeah. Right? I mean, and in that way, it's not unlike a lot of other discussions. It's not just comedy that's like that. You know, people are calling themselves feminist and, you know, they don't. It's like, what exactly are
you? Like, I often think the term is being used to give it an edge when the comedy itself needs an edge that it didn't otherwise have.
Yes. But there should definitely, I've always liked those sorts of comedians who are out there, like Louis C.K. or that sort of thing.
Amy Schumer's train wreck?
I have not. And we did discuss it's stuff like that, you know. It's like I'm getting the wrap it up signal. The music is playing and I over inside.
Well, I knew I would get you started by talking about comedy, because I know that's something you're really interested in. Yeah. So I'm
purposefully egging Mr. Haven on.
I did that. I do that a lot.
Yes, you do.
Yes. Poking the bear.
We should. It's time for the safe word.
Alrighty.
No, I'm anti-safe word now.
Okay, well, fine. I'll say the safe word.
I really think it's limiting my options, my free speech, my choices.
You can be in a safe place right there on your chair.
I don't think I should have to say one word.
Bananas.
Boom. She dropped the mic.
I said the word that I wanted to say. Bananas. Bananas. Coming down the stairs.
Okay, that was the...
All right, everyone, quiet down. Let's get this meeting started. As you know, our profits have been slumping enough that the top brass is ready and willing to take an axe to this whole division. MacGuffin Toys shares have dropped in the stock market steadily for the last 3 years. We need to turn things around and steer the company into the black, or nobody's safe. As you may or may not be aware, we have won the licensing to the biggest surprise blockbuster of the summer, Galaxy Woman, which is breaking box office records left and right. This sci-fi superhero nonsense fad seems to be catching on with young people. We need toy ideas, and we need them yesterday.
Excuse me, Mr. Codger, what is Galaxy Woman again?
Jesus monkey fucking Christ, Brent. Have you been living under an island for the last 6 months? Are you in fact as mentally deficient as I suspect you to be?
I am sorry, Mr. Codger. I should have kept up with things more, but I've been quarantined while recovering from Ebola. I've only recently returned to the States.
Are you fucking kidding me? Ebola? You had Ebola? Brent, you worthless goat sucker, have you given me fucking Ebola? Are we all going to spend our last painful days shitting out our intestines? How in the holy hell did you get Ebola?
In Africa. I work in our West African division. My office is in Sierra Leone. Anyway, I'm no longer contagious. I haven't been for weeks. The doctor cleared me and...
Jesus shit-throwing Christ, I hope so. If you've given me a bowl of bread, I swear I'm going to bury you in that cheap seersucker suit you're wearing.
Again, I apologize for almost dying of Ebola, sir.
Brenda, will you catch up this human petri dish on Galaxy Woman?
Certainly, sir. Galaxy Woman is a property of Uncanny Comics, a subsidiary of Argus Pictures, which acquired the failing company 6 years ago. Since then, Argus has aggressively entered the already competitive superhero adaptation market, but has proven to be very successful. Galaxy Woman is the latest film to be released and has already broken all domestic box office records in sales and attendance, even adjusting for inflation.
Satisfied, Brett.
But what's it about? What makes Galaxy Woman special?
Oh, I can feel that one. Galaxy Woman is actually police officer Maxine Masters, who was almost killed in the line of duty while rescuing Chancellor Vorp of planet Argon from the intergalactic supervillain Master Magnastar. Magnastar was attempting to assassinate the Chancellor on his diplomatic mission to Earth in order to steal the gift to the human race, the Galaxy Suit, which would give its wearer super-powered abilities. Maxine was given the suit as a thank you by the dying Chancellor Vorp, which not only gives her the amazing abilities such as the powers of flight, super strength, endurance, and agility, and the ability to fire gamma lasers out of her breast, but also...
Her breast?
Yes, her breast. Galaxy Woman was originally created in 1997 by French comic creator Cynthia Myers as a commentary and satire on the comic book industry as a whole and to illustrate feminist issues specifically. The mammary gamma lasers are meant to illustrate both the hypersexualization of women in the comic industry, but also to poke fun at the old arbitrary comic book trope of energy shooting comic book characters.
Jesus, come guzzling Christ, Brianne. I asked for an explanation, not an oratory on the complete history of funny books.
Sorry, sir.
All right. All cut up now, Brent.
Yes, sir. I'm sorry, sir. So we just need to crank out some toys of Galaxy Woman, then.
Welcome to the fucking meeting, Brent. Yes, we need to do some action figures and race cars and shit based on the movie Galaxy Woman. So what can we do?
How about an action figure line based on Officer Bill Braxter? He rides a motorcycle in the movie.
Actually, that was Galaxy Woman. She rides the motorcycle when she is rescuing her partner, Bill, who is incapacitated and carries him on her shoulders while she's fighting off the Gorkon invaders while also trying to maintain her secret identity.
Right. Whatever. Anyway, we could do a figure line featuring the Bill Baxter guy on some toy motorcycles. Maybe some of those Gorkon invaders to chase him.
I love it. What else?
Well, didn't Galaxy Woman have that sidekick, that kid photographer?
Jimmy Jenkins?
Yeah, Jimmy Jenkins. He doesn't do a whole lot in the movie, but we could do a line of Jimmy Jenkins-centric toys. Maybe Jimmy Jenkins riding on a motorcycle.
Genius! What else?
Well, we can't forget the baddie, can we? Master Magnastar. He's a great villain. Wonderful design. Giant, pulsating brain. Anyway, we do Master Magnastar everything. Action figures, giant-sized dolls, playsets, shampoo, dispensers, everything.
Great. Anything else? Remember, we want to squeeze this licensing teat for all the milk money we can get.
Well, obviously, we will be doing products based on Galaxy Woman herself.
Right. Wait, how do you mean?
I mean Galaxy Woman action figures, dolls, whatever.
I'm not following you. You mean action figures based on a female character?
Well, she is the title character.
Well, yeah, but she's female.
I'm still not following. You can't seriously be proposing we expend our limited resources on manufacturing little woman action figures.
Why not?
Little boys don't play with little girl action figures.
Yeah, I mean, I did, but generally, no.
You played with girl toys?
Yeah. I mean, you know, like I had a Princess Leia action figure.
You pansy!
How does that make him any less masculine?
Well, because he's playing with girl dolls.
Action figures.
They don't make girly action figures.
What about Teela from He-Man, Scarlet and Lady Jane from G.I. Joe? They had lots of female characters. Didn't you play with G.I. Joe, Brian?
Well, yes, but...
Well, there you are. Does that make you a pansy, Brian?
Yes, it does. Girls don't play with action figures, and we can't market action figures to pansy boys.
I played with action figures.
I still do.
Her desk is covered with toys.
That proves nothing.
It's the 21st century. Gender roles are becoming less heteronormative.
Yes, and the collector market is expanding like crazy.
Half of our market is made up by adults, and female adults are a hugely growing collector market.
This is madness.
I want a Galaxy Woman action figure.
Me too.
Me too.
Actually, I'd kind of like one too. Not to mention my kids would love Galaxy Woman toys.
I am not going to okay the manufacturer of an entire toy line because your pansy kids want to shoot lasers out of a set of little toy titties.
Why not?
Yeah, why not?
Because I'm a grouchy old white male, 45 to 75 years old, and change makes me terrified.
There, there, sir.
Don't touch me, you reprobate.
So, no Galaxy Woman action figures?
Absolutely not.
How about a doll?
A proper doll. Like a Barbie doll. That might work.
With properly associated paraphernalia.
Like a blow dryer, kitchen set, a pink convertible.
How about a motorcycle?
Women don't ride motorcycles.
Doesn't your wife have a Kawasaki?
Lies and slander. That mewling Quim couldn't drive a shopping cart.
Trouble at home, sir?
She left me. Can you believe it? She called me a foul-mouthed, fossilized, misogynist gas bag. Me!
Hard to imagine.
But sir, isn't she, you know, the owner of the company? Isn't she your boss?
Nope.
She's not?
Nope. She fired me.
Wait, she what?
Yes. Today's my last day. Then it's a golden parachute into the milk and honey land of early retirement, and I'm going to sue that vindictive bitch for all the alimony in the world.
Oh, so we can just ignore you and do whatever we want later.
Right.
Well, yes, technically, but...
So Galaxy Woman toys for everyone.
You wouldn't do that to me.
Oh, yes, we would.
Absolutely.
I can't wait.
Ungrateful bastards. Oh, look at the time. I have to clean out my desk before 3 p.m. today.
Goodbye, sir.
I've hated every second of working under you.
Don't let the doorknob hit you in the ass on the way out.
No, sir. Don't leave me here.
So we're in agreement then. All the Galaxy Woman toys.
Yes.
Yes. Now what do we discuss?
Let's give ourselves raises.
Raises!
Hooray! Hooray!
Fucking Brent.
Are working.
The thing where we say bye.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Got it.
Okay. Thanks for listening to PSF, Promoting Secular Feminism. You can find us online at facebook.com/promoting secular feminism. On Twitter, we're at secular feminism, and our website is promotingsecularfeminism.com. If you'd like to contact us, you can email us at PromotingSecularFeminism@gmail.com.
You can rate us on iTunes.
Yes, yeah. If you are a fan, please rate and review us on iTunes.
We're really great, so give us 5 stars.
Yay! I'm misbehaving.
It's not my line yet.
Yeah.
Shh, 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 shh. Okay.
I'm misbehaving, keeping Trump out of your rump.
And I'm Amanda Wright. And we'll see you next Tuesday. And I have fairy wings.
The hammer is my penis. What is this saying? Everyone's a hero in their own way. You and mostly me. And you. And meet my girlfriend Penny. Yeah, we totally had sex. Somebody give me some goddamn Fritos.
It's the laughing.
Fritos.
That's so great.
Let's see what happens with
this. I managed to make every single voice creepy.
Yes, you do.
Everyone's a hero in their own way. Everyone's got villains they must face.
Okay, that's going to give me nightmares.
It's great.
I love it.
I'm like the dude bro version of Ursula in Mermaid.
You're as if Satan had possessed Reagan in The Exorcist. Was a surfer.
I'm the J-Man.
Dude, your mother sucks cocks in hell.
Dude.
I'm pretty sure this was the one we used for that. Except we left this on so that she had to...
Let's just do the ring thing, or that, whatever it is.
Yeah.
And didn't.
All right, shall we proceed?
Yeah.
You think you can?
God damn it.
You think you can manage? See, he's just going to screw with you.
Too much fun.
I'm misbehaving. And we're promoting secular feminism. Wait.
That's the intro. Yes. Both of you like that.
That's great.
Hang on.
Wait, I love it.
Okay.
I'm going to turn that off here.
I can do the segment. Wait, what do you want to call your segment?
You mean, Feminism. I'm Feminism 101, talks about female comedians.
And it's kind of, it's about feminist humor.
Oh my god, you sound like me.
Do I? Oh my god, I totally do.
A little bit, yeah.
Oh my god.
Wait, say something about Doctor Who.
Oh my god, on the last episode of Doctor Who, there was like this Daleks were attacking the Cybermen. Yes, Daleks.
Oh no.
And it was so great. And oh my god, Peter Capaldi is, I think, now totally my doctor. And like, I think I'm a lot less
Valley Girl than that.
Well, maybe in your head, but maybe in everybody else's head, maybe like, you know, you're totally Valley Girl.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
Fucking Brent.
I think he's...
So now everybody...
I think he's stereotyping you, Misty.
Everybody's going to sound like this now.
Yay, maybe.
Oh, my God.
Do we have the naming segment for Mr. Haven? Did anybody vote? I vote Godfrey.
I don't think anybody actually has voted because that episode hasn't released yet.
Oh, yeah.
I think Godfrey is like the perfect name for Scott.
I do too.
I think we should totally use that name for him.
Godfrey Haven.
This is bad for my bladder.
Oh yeah, I totally have like a bladder the size of a peanut. And whenever I inhale, I have to pee.
The Tinkle Song.
So Feminism 101
is about feminist comedians.
Okay.
Or we could call it Social Justice Comedians. I think my voice is probably high enough to begin with.
Okay. So Social Justice
Humor.
Humor. There
oh my god, my stomach just growled.
She's adorable.
She is.
My
not that you're not.
Just growled. I'm really hungry.
Not that you're not normally
you sound like
adorable.
You sound like a tiny little something that I want to adopt and keep in an aquarium.
A fairy.
A drown?
No, an aquarium that has like a couch and a TV and a little.
So a terrarium.
A terrarium.
Yes.
Yeah. Like a hamster cage or something. Yeah, I'll change
it every now and then. Like one of those magic genie bottles?
No.
I'm gonna shit myself.
That sounded like me.
Could you make sure all the furniture is ergonomic so it'll fit my fairy wings?
Yeah, okay. I got it. I'm on it. You got this.
I need ergonomic furniture appropriate for fairy wings.
Do you want to do the...
No Religion Required promo thing first?
Oh, sure.
We should probably not have these voices for that.
You sound so much like me when you say, oh my God.
It's really scary that I sound fucking like you and you sound like me with the voices changed. Yeah. That's really scary.
It's
I
really spooky.
I had no idea that that actually could occur.
I had no idea that we had such similar voices.
Yeah.
It's the stars aligning.